Well, we thank God for a wonderful praise session. We've come now to the last lecture, message of this camp. I can see how the Lord is leading, because the message we are going to close this camp with is in fact introductory to our next series and our next camp as we introduce Peter's ladder. I can also see how the Lord is moving, because this watch is going to be sweeter and more intense, especially as we take hold of the light, surrender all, and grow in grace and climb Peter's ladder. And we're not to leave this camp meeting as we came. Times are too solemn. The mark of the beast is around the corner, and Jesus Christ will have a people who fully reflect his character, have full victory over sin, and reflect to the universe that God is pure agape love, and defeat Satan and all of his enemies by using only pure agape love. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you indeed for this 2015 camp meeting. As we are into our final moments and we look back on the entire week, we see your blessing, we see your guidance, we see the light you've sent, we see the messages calling us up higher in Jesus Christ, and we thank you. Even for what some may consider issues and problems, we thank you, not because you caused them, but because when they occur, you use them to refine us. Now, as we come to our final lecture and then our closing ceremony, we want you to pour upon us your Holy Spirit in early and latter rain measure. Bring us to that position we talked about this morning, the ear. Lock us in the surrender position in Jesus Christ. Give us victory over every defect. Give us faith to believe the true everlasting gospel given to Adventism in the 1888 message, a message rejected by hierarchy and still opposed by those in high positions. And the character of God message, again, a message ridiculed and persecuted, but we thank you for it. We thank you that we are not ashamed of the gospel and not ashamed of your character of pure love. Anoint us now with your Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. One of the things that A.T. Jones mentioned in the 1888 message is that when we read in Romans 8 that all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose, when we read in Romans 8 that God has predestined us in Jesus Christ to glory, the reformer A.T. Jones says in his 1895 lectures that God has already worked out that eternal purpose in Jesus Christ. That in Jesus Christ we see that all things work together for good. In his crucifixion, his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, his glorification, and his enthronement, that is God's purpose for every human being. God's purpose for you and for me is not satisfied until we are seated in heavenly places, Ephesians 1, 3, and 4, in Jesus Christ. And these realities we claim by faith and accept by faith, that God has worked out a complete victory for us in Jesus Christ. He, as the representative man, all of us were in him. And as individuals now, when we believe it and surrender, we have it as an experience of faith in our character. And last camp, we concentrated on the gospel, the objective gospel. This camp, we see how the gospel gives us growth in grace and ripening. And I just want to read this section from the camp book, quoting A.T. Jones, page 130, 131, before we are introduced to Peter's ladder. Page 130, 131 in the camp book, Gospel Ripening. I'll be quoting here from A.T. Jones' lecture. Lecture 22, 1895. Page 130, see where we are? Now, we can look at that yet farther. I will say again that the Lord, in order to show mankind what he's prepared for us, what his purpose is concerning every man, has set before us an example so that everyone in the world can see God's purpose concerning himself and can see it fully worked out. God's purpose concerning us in this world is to keep us from sinning in spite of all the power of sin and Satan. Praise the Lord. And he's done it in Christ for us, and we have it in Christ as we claim it by faith. That is, in his power, he himself shall be manifested instead of ourselves. So God wants to bring us to that point where we are emptied of self. Only God is manifested. That is the position of the ear in Mark 4, 26 to 29. And as we shall see in a moment, it is a critical position in Peter's letter in 2 Peter 1. But just to go on. Pardon? I missed out a sentence. Yes, his purpose concerning himself and us in this world is that God shall be manifested in sinful flesh. Thank you. That is, in his power, he himself shall be manifested instead of ourselves. It is therefore that our wicked self shall be crucified, shall be dead and buried, and that we shall be raised from that deadness in sin and uncircumcision of the flesh to newness of life in Jesus Christ and in God, seated at his right hand and glorified. That is the Lord's purpose concerning you and me. And then the section entitled Jesus our High Priest will prepare us, just this little section, page 131, Jesus our High Priest will prepare us. You just heard the song in the sanctuary. Now our High Priest is in the heavenly sanctuary, and as we know, Jesus is performing three tasks in the heavenly sanctuary. First, he continues to intercede for mankind by virtue of his infinite sacrifice. Two, he is performing the work of investigative judgment and blotting out the sins of the righteous dead. And thirdly, he is preparing a remnant to be victorious over sin, to fully reflect his character, in whom only God will be manifested, to face the time of Jacob's trouble, a time of trouble such as never was. Listen to what John says. He will prepare us. Praise the Lord. Jesus will prepare us. We cannot prepare ourselves. We tried a long while to justify ourselves, to make ourselves just right, and thus get ready for the coming of the Lord. We have tried to do so well that we could approve ourselves and be satisfied and say, now I can meet the Lord. But we were never satisfied. No, it is not done that way. Whom he justified, them he glorified. Now, since God justifies, it is his own work. And when he's ready for us to meet the Lord, it will be all right because it is he himself who prepares us to meet the Lord. Praise the Lord. It is he himself who prepares us to meet the Lord. Now, this brings us now to open your Bibles with me to 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter 1. Second Peter chapter 1. You have it? Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. What an opening exhortation. We receive faith through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. When the Holy Spirit directs our eyes seeing Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, revealing a love that is unimaginable, that love gives us faith. Faith comes by hearing, Romans 10:17, and hearing by the word of God. That love of God revealed in Jesus Christ gives us faith. Praise the Lord. Verse 2, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. So the knowledge of God is revealed in Jesus Christ. There is nowhere else in the Bible or in the world where we get the correct picture of God than in Jesus Christ. That is why all the Bible from Genesis to Revelation must be interpreted by the life and death of Jesus Christ. He is the exact image of the invisible God. The law came by Moses, grace and truth by Jesus Christ. So when we want to interpret any part of the Bible, we look at it entirely through Jesus Christ. That's the only way we will correctly interpret it. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Look at verse 3. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Where else in the Bible are we told that God has given us all things? Romans 8:32 says, verse 31 says, what shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that did not spare his son, but gave him up. Notice the mechanism there. But gave him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? So God has given us all things we need for victory and growth to perfection in Jesus Christ. And this is what Peter is saying here. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Verse 4. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. And by the way, where are these promises? 2 Corinthians 1:20. All the promises of God are yes and amen in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the promise of God. And in him, all that God has given us is fulfilled and is a reality. And the new covenant is believing the promise of God and receiving the promise of God by believing and receiving Jesus Christ. So we become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, through desire, through selfish covetousness. That is what has the world in a mess. Every problem in this world is the result of human selfishness and choice, which came from Satan's selfish choice. War, political turmoil, troubles anywhere at all, troubles in the family, at work, in the church, all stem from some manifestation of selfishness against God's love. And now Peter goes on, verse 5, and we have to learn these steps, understand them, and experience them. Verse 5, let's read it together. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. That's how the King James Version translation puts it. Now, let me hear you repeat those steps in this ladder. Faith, virtue, knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, and charity. That's the King James Version. Okay. Now, this is a ladder. The Spirit of Prophecy calls it the ladder of sanctification. And how many steps there are? 8 steps. Remember the symbolic numbers of the Bible? There's a study we have to go through again. We went through that 30 years ago. We have to go through it again. 7, the number of completeness. 8, the number of victory. 8 steps. And the Spirit of Prophecy says when we reach the uppermost round, the King James Version calls it charity. It's really the same thing as 1 Corinthians 13, God's agape love. When we become mature in agape love character, she says it's just a step into glory. We step from the uppermost round into glory. Now, I'm going to introduce this part. This is the foretaste of studies to come. If in the parable of Mark 4, or the harvest parable of Mark 4, 26 to 29. Jesus says there's first the blade, then the ear, then the full corn in the ear. We described last night and this morning that the ear when we reach the stage of the year, we are locked, L-O-C-K-E-D, locked in surrender to Jesus Christ, so that only God is manifested, the soul is emptied of every defilement, and the latter rain then carries us on to the full corn in the ear, maturity, sinless maturity in agape love character. So the question is, where in Peter's ladder, which point in Peter's ladder corresponds to the ear in Jesus' parable? Remember, the parable of Jesus must be the foundation for all understanding of growth. Now, when we read in the King James Version these steps, it's good to read them in other versions. Good to look at the Greek. Faith. The Greek for faith is pistis. Trust, belief to the point of entire surrender to the one you trust. Remember Abraham? God called Abraham. Abraham believed God, trusted God, didn't know where he was going, but he surrendered and went. Faith is trust, belief, surrender, receiving all that the promise gives, and it therefore issues forth in obedience to God. Faith without obedience doesn't exist, because James says, faith without works is, anything that's dead doesn't exist. Faith, pistis. Look at the next one, virtue. The Greek word for virtue is arete, which means arete, R-E-T-E. That's the English spelling. Arete, which means a mind that is strong morally for right. So Christ's victory over sin is fixed there. Arete, virtue. Then comes knowledge. The Greek word for knowledge is gnosis, G-N-O-S-I-S. And in the early church, they had Gnostic teachers infiltrating with a strange kind of knowledge. The knowledge that God is talking about is the knowledge of his word as fully understood in Jesus Christ. Then after that comes a key word, patience. Now in the Bible, there are two main words translated patience. There's a word called makrothumio in the Greek, which means that you're waiting on a brother or you're waiting on your wife, that kind of patience. And then there's another word called hupomone, that's the noun, from the Greek verb hupomino. Now, the verb hupomino means to stay under. I will give the illustration as boys going to the sea down St. Peter where I grew up, and the fellas going in the sea, because we had to learn to swim from early. Before you could walk, you was in the sea. And the fellas would go down and decide who could stay under the water the longest. That reminds me of what A.T. Jones says. A.T. Jones says, you don't go to Christ and take out what you want and leave. You must plunge yourself into him and remain in him. It is staying under, submerging, absolute surrender. That is what this word translated patience is. In other words, although the King James translators translates it as patience, perseverance, steadfastness, remaining under. So the Greek word here is hupomone, coming from the verb hupomino, which means to get into Christ with absolute surrender and to stay under. Look at the things that bring us from under Christ, huh? We are surrendered today. As we said this morning, somebody says something bad to us, we blow up. But God must bring us to the point, the stage called the ear, this stage here. Which point this is? This point number five? Five. Five is the number of grace. Point number five, where we are locked, L-O-C-K-E-D, locked in surrender to Jesus, so that under all circumstances and in all places and in all things, only God is manifested. Not our bad temper, not our anger, not our selfishness, not our retaliation. Christ-like character. And that is best seen in loving our enemies. Loving your friend, Jesus says, you're no better than the heathen. When you love your enemies, you're like God. You hear what that says? When you love your enemies, you're like God. Hupomone. Now that is the point, translated patience, that is parallel in Peter's letter. So faith, virtue, knowledge. I missed out one, didn't I? Which one I missed out? Before you get to patience, what you must have? Ah, you let me miss that one out? Patience comes after temperance. And the Greek word for temperance is self-restraint. Temperance means moderation, self-restraint. It means avoiding all that is injurious and the careful use of that which is good. So there is faith, virtue, knowledge, temperance, and no person who is intemperate can reach the point of absolute surrender. That's why for us as a people, the health reform is so important. All those who are preparing for translation will put away animal flesh from their diet. It isn't a threat. It isn't even a warning. It is a prophecy. All those who are preparing for translation will put away animal flesh from their diet. They will put away all that is intoxicating. They will eat at proper times. If there's a 3 meal a day, it's 3 meal a day. If it is 2, it is 2. They will drink water in between their meals. And God will have a people who are strictly temperate, strictly health reformed, and who are self-controlled. You can't reach hupomone remaining under in surrender. I can't reach that if I'm not temperate. And once we reach hupomone, which is that absolute surrender, the stage of the year, latter-rain ripening will carry us through godliness, brotherly kindness, and agape love. Godliness, brotherly kindness, and agape love. Godliness in the Greek is eusebia, which means piety. Brotherly kindness, everybody should know, what's the Greek for brotherly love? Philadelphia. Philadelphia. Brotherly love. And of course, the Greek for God's love is agape. Now, we are told in the spirit of prophecy that all of these, you don't have to wait for one to be finished to add the next. They are added both simultaneously and consecutively. And in the very near future, when we look at them in greater detail, we will follow this ladder on and on, getting to know it. And listen, brethren, the times to which we've come now with the whole world collapsing, we have to reach the point of complete surrender and permanent surrender, not surrender today and out tomorrow, locked in surrender. And as we're told in the spirit of prophecy, we have to climb this ladder. Now, climbing this ladder is not a works program. You know, when we are told to add and the Holy Spirit multiplies, what does it mean to add? When we recognize our deficiency and we by faith claim all that God has given us in Jesus Christ, when we see where we are lacking in knowledge, we claim the knowledge that God has given us in Jesus Christ. But listen to me, will God come and stuff that knowledge in your head? No, you have to get up when the days come and read your Bible, pray and read and study. God gives you the knowledge, but you are a free moral agent. You have to study. Similarly, you recognize that you have a defect, troubling virtue. You claim all that God has given you, and as a free moral agent, you ask God to expel it, and he says, put away the evil thought. When the evil thoughts come in, put them away. As you make the effort, God adds the power, because you're a free moral agent. And so on for each of these. As you add, God multiplies. Now, the Apostle Paul gives us the formula in 2 Corinthians 3:18. And it's commented on by Sister White in Desire of Ages 302. It's an amazing formula. Paul says, what does Paul say in 2 Corinthians 3:18? That by beholding, we become changed from glory to glory. The spirit of prophecy expands on it beautifully. If the eye is kept fixed on Jesus, notice this. If the eye is kept fixed on Jesus, the spirit ceases not his work of conforming our souls into his image. Woo! You heard that? If the eye is kept fixed on Jesus, the Holy Spirit ceases not his work of conforming my poor, wretched, sinful soul into the image of Christ. What is my work? I keep my eye fixed on Jesus. And as I see all of the beauty of Jesus' character, all of his love and compassion, how he died for a wretch like me, as I see that and keep admiring him by beholding, I am transformed. I will never forget when I was a teenager, I used to go down by the sea studying for exams, and I decided to take a swim out. And I was fairly far out. When a fella passed on the bridge and shouted out maliciously, "A shark!" And it was a particular tree. Here was I used to mark in the old time days. And I kept my eye fixed on that tree and get to shore. My bath mats nearly come off. Get to shore in a flash. My eye fixed on the tree. I nearly swam up to the tree and all. When Satan is behind us, keep your eye fixed on Jesus and the Holy Spirit will carry you forward up this ladder. Up this ladder. If the eye is kept fixed on Jesus, the Spirit ceases not his work. Whose work it is? The Spirit. You see how we add? We admire Jesus and see what he has that we don't have and know that it's all given. And as we focus on it and meditate on it, and know that we are in Christ and Christ in us, the Holy Spirit does the work of conforming my soul into his image. We're coming to the end of this gap. 2014 was a rough year, 2015 worse. And these are the beginning of sorrows. We can't even tell if we'll see each other again individually. We don't know what will happen. Here in Barbados, a few days ago, a young teacher visited his relatives at work, it was, and two gangs shooting wild, and the boy is dead. We're living in perilous times, as the Apostle Paul said, and things are going to get worse. And things are going to reach the point where the authorities are going to say, things are too bad, let's pull back the reins. Now, as I said before, just before we finish, and we're going to finish in a consecratory prayer before we hand over to Brother Newton in the closing ceremony. Freedom is very important to God and to mankind. God has made his creatures free. What Satan is causing people to do is to abuse freedom. Because anytime you use freedom to break God's law, you're abusing freedom. See what is happening in the world. Man marrying man, woman marrying woman, all sorts of things, abusing the law of God. And listen to what will happen. As the abuse of freedom continues, Satan will come with his next trick. You see how bad the world is? It is because of freedom. Answer me, is the world bad because of freedom? No, the world is bad because the abuse of freedom. People choosing to abuse freedom. And then Satan will say, well, they've got to get these hooligans back to church on Sunday, and the only way they can get it done is pass the Sunday law. And when that Sunday law is passed, the whole of the religious world will see it as the best way to save the world. So when we get up onto the ladder and it says, no, it is not right to interfere with freedom of conscience, and it is not right to impose a religious duty by law, they will say, see that group there? That keeping noise about the seventh-day Sabbath? We can go and get rid of them from the earth. Revelation. No, we won't be allowed to buy ourselves. And eventually the death decree will be actualized. We will be sentenced to death. Sentenced to death. And we will have to have the faith of Jesus fully matured. The righteousness of God fully matured. Victory over sin would have come before at the stage of the ear, but now we'll be developing into the full corn in the ear. We'll be moving through godliness, brotherly kindness, and maturity in agape love, the top of Peter's ladder. So it means that every successive camp, we don't know how long we have to go in this watch. This is a midnight watch. A midnight watch is a serious time. Behold, at midnight, the cry went up, Matthew 25, behold, the bridegroom cometh. If we surrender to God and God's people around the world surrender to him, light and truth will come. As we surrender, he can get his people ready in a flash. The delay has been our problem. Skylarking with sin, meddling and remaining in lukewarmness, when God has sent the 1888 message to deliver us from lukewarmness. So we're not going to go away from this camp and say that was a good camp and go back to routine. We have to be praying and studying, keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus so that the Holy Spirit will give us victory over sin, bring us to the point of absolute surrender, and then ripen us. Was your hymn? Was it number of your hymn? 569? 569, Sister Flo. 569. We don't want Jesus to pass us this camp. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. We're going to have a prayer of consecration before we go into our closing ceremony. Some people may have come to this camp because a friend told them come. They came to for socializing. That's all right. Jesus meets you wherever you are to bring you forward. But God wants us to surrender all. Outside, I'm inviting you in for this prayer of consecration. All who are outside downstairs, who are at the camp but not at the camp, everybody. Because you may have come to this camp with one agenda, but if you don't leave with the right agenda in Jesus Christ, you would have wasted God's time. And the hour is too late for us not to mean business with God. I must pray for you, you must pray for me. None of us is any better than the other, but God loves us all. And he has paid an infinite price for our salvation. And as we sing the first stanza, and as Sister Flo continues to play it, we are going to consecrate ourselves to God. Don't let Satan fool you that God doesn't forgive you. Once you confess and repent, having believed the gospel of what he's done for all mankind, paying the redemption price, when we confess and repent, the promise is he will cleanse us from all unrighteousness and forgive us and cast those sins in the bottom of the sea. Don't let Satan fool you or keep you in bondage. This is the time to make an entire consecration, a complete commitment. We just signed those beautiful theme songs in our camp, dating back from 1986, 85 and 86, when we held our first camp meetings. We've been here too long. It is time to mean business with God. It is time to surrender all. It is time for victory over sin. And it's time for lateral growth in righteousness. Brother Bruce, we'll sing the first stanza. Necessity. If we are wayside soil, we want to be born again. We want that soil turned into good soil. If the mindset is stony ground, a quick shooting up and then the hot sun and you're gone, we want the rocks thrown out of that soil. If it is thorny soil with the cares and perplexities of life choking you, we want all those weeds pulled up. We want the mindset soil, the attitude to God, to be good soil. If you're just coming to church, drifting along, and have never been born again, you can't start growing in grace unless you're born again. And we want this to be a time of commitment, consecration, the new birth, or the renewed conversion. And we want God to make the next year between this camp and the next camp a year of unprecedented growth and victory over sin.
Good afternoon, brethren. Before the prayer of consecration, I am moved to, because of interaction with some persons in the camp, to appeal to our young people who know that they are very, very on the verge of surrendering to God. We have some young people among us. Sometimes we discount them, but we don't know what is going on in their souls if you don't draw close to them. And I am impressed to invite those persons who they know who they are, for a special mention in this consecratory prayer. No pressure on anyone, but you know the Spirit of God has been drawing you. You know you have been asking questions about being born again and those kind of things. Young men, young women, asking questions. And I want you, even if you don't come up here, I want Dr. Douglin in his prayer to at least mention the youth in a very special way. I am one of the of those who are of the persuasion that many of our youth will not get to the kind of ages they anticipate and get the kind of careers and family lives. Now, I am not saying that 10, 15 years wouldn't elapse, but I'm saying also that it's very tenuous when it comes to what happens tomorrow, the next day, and the next day. So I really want to appeal especially to the youth to consider their ways and don't think that you have all the tomorrows put down. Youth have a way of thinking that I am invincible. I lost a son at 16 years old whom I thought I would have probably, of course, be buried by. Not because of that, but it just flashed my mind that never think you're invincible, youth. I'm appealing to youth particularly because the ways of youth are full of folly generally. But I think with the experience that we've been having this camp and in recent months and years, really, that I think that our youth need to seriously step up to the plate knowing that as time goes on, the older men goes off the scene and they have to take a stand. Are they going to allow God's church to collapse? And I want to challenge youth, both female and male, to consider the call of God on you. And you know that God has been pulling at your heartstring. Don't be afraid. It might look frightening. Don't be afraid. God is willing to stand by you because he's for you. So, Dr. Douglin, as you pray, please remember the young men, particularly from this church, and the young ladies as well.
Thank you. What I was going to do, I was going to allow you to make the appeal so that the youth come forward and ask yourself and Brother Prince Charles to give a special prayer of consecration for the young people coming forward before we have the final prayer of consecration. So I'm appealing to young persons who want to commit themselves to the Lord and they sense the convicting power of the Holy Spirit to come forward and take a stand for Jesus Christ. Wherever you are, whoever you are, come forward and take a stand for Jesus Christ. all the young people, young men and women, who feel the pull of the Holy Spirit, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Do not push away the Holy Spirit. But if you feel the convicting pull of the Holy Spirit, come forward for this prayer of consecration. We'll sing the second stanza. Brother Bruce.
Let me at thy throne of mercy find a sweet relief. Kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief.
Let's pray, please. Our gracious Father and God, we thank you for our youths. And Father, we thank you for the children who have come forward. Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. And so, Father, we want your hand of love and consecration to touch each little child, each teenager, each adult who has come forward, because in their hearts they are children of the kingdom. And, O Father, we thank you for the privilege that you have granted us at this convocation. Some must have come late. Some must have come just at the time of closing, but thank you, Father, because they came. Forgive us for all sin. And as these young ones look to Jesus Christ, may they keep in their hearts that Jesus was once their age. And the very things that they are experiencing, Jesus would have experienced. But we thank you that he submitted himself to his Father, who worked in him to will and to do of his good pleasure. And he came out victorious. And therefore, he has given that victory to each child today. And so, Father, each child bowing here, may they understand at their age, Jesus won the victory for them. And more than winning it, he gives it to them freely. And he has given them eternal life. So that each one of us who have submitted our lives to Christ are filled with the fullness of Christ in God. And so, Father, we thank you for them. Keep their hearts, for their guardians and their parents and the elders and all those of experience who are around them. May they wrap their hands of mercy and love and influence, of meekness and approachableness and counsel, so that they may be guided and guarded, so that they may grow up into the head Jesus Christ, and that they may take up their work, their calling, what you have given to them, they may take it up faithfully. Help them to understand that this road is one of sacrifice, one of inconvenience, one of delay, one of pain and suffering. But look not at that, but look at Jesus Christ, the high priest of our salvation. And he will bring you through more than conquerors. Because in him is absolute victory. And so we thank you for every one of them, the girls and the boys. Oh, Father, we bless your name because of them. And may they continue to, that this is the beginning of a new experience as they submit fully to you. But we consecrate their parents also because they play a vital role in their lives. Also their guardians. Also those who affect their lives in some way or other. May we stay close to them so that they will bless us. We will learn patience from them and they will grow in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, because you have heard and because you have answered in Jesus' name. Amen.
Wonderful Father, we thank you for your greatness, your love, and your mercy. We thank you, dear Lord, for the extension of your wonderful hand towards the youth and the young children of this congregation. We lift them up to you now, dear Jesus, knowing that you've told us, suffer little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for this is the material of heaven. Father, we thank you for them. We see them, dear Lord, in many instances in their waywardness. But we see them crying out to you in a way that we adults must understand that as we draw near to them and show them Jesus, they'll be impressed by him and they too will surrender to him. Amen. I ask you in a special way, dear Lord, to remember the you first of all, the young men who have come forward and the young ladies. May they know, dear Lord, that they are stones and plants in your garden and your temple, and that they will be leaders in your cause in the not too distant future. And may they consider, dear Lord, the complete surrender of their soul to you, even as they see the collapse going on around them. May they, dear Lord, keep their souls in Christ that they can be delivered and help point some of their other friends to Jesus to escape the collapse. Oh, Father, continue to draw them. I know, dear Lord, that you're drawing them. They have been asking questions about being baptized. They've been asking questions about the new birth. And, oh, Father, by your Holy Spirit, continue to trouble their souls that they might yield to you in full surrender to the honor of your name. We know, dear Father, you love children. And, dear Jesus, you are youth. You understand the vagaries of life that afflict them. And you have said to them, come, and you will carry them on. Amen. So in a special way, dear Lord, I ask you to wrap your arms around them. As adults and leaders in this congregation, the various congregations from which they have come, may we know our responsibility. The responsibility, Lord, of shepherding, of guiding, and turning their eyes to Jesus and not away from him. May we be tender and gentle in our dealing. Deliver us from the harshness that we've exhibited on many occasions to them who just need tender love and affection, but they don't know how to ask for it. May we be older, sense and see, and respond, dear Lord, to the cries of their heart. Remember our young children. They too have souls, dear Lord, that you've paid the redemption price for. Amen. Because like Joshua, like Josiah, age 7, who came to the kingdom as a king, there was Esther, young people, dear Lord, that you use mightily. May our youth and our children realize that you have a responsibility, that you have a role for them to play. And may we as adults direct and lead their minds to Jesus that they might truly see him and surrender. So have mercy upon them, we pray. Forgive them of their sins. And let them know, dear Lord, that there's nothing that they can do that is wrong that you have not already forgiven them for. And that when they bring their sins to you, take them from them and make them new. So attend to them. I beseech you in the name of Jesus and bless them in a special way today. We thank you for having them and receiving them in Jesus' precious name.
Thank you, and we're going to sing the next stanza, then invite consecratory prayer on behalf of the congregation. And children and young people, as you go back, remember God loves you, His Spirit is calling you. And he who has begun a good work will finish it unto perfection. Next stanza. And then Brother Leacock will give us the consecratory prayer for the entire congregation.
Trusting only in thy merit, would I seek thy face. Heal my wounded, broken spirit.
Our dear God and Father in heaven, we thank you that you are an adorable God. Amen. We thank you that you love us so much, and you proved it in the gift of your Son. And you gave all in him, surely you will not withhold any other gift from us. Amen. We recognize that you are more willing to give us your Holy Spirit than we are to receive it. You are more willing to give us your good gifts than we are to give gifts to our children. We thank you for the gift of your the sacrifice of your Son. And we know that his sacrifice will avail for every single soul present. Amen. Enable us to recognize that you are all out to save, and you will not stop until you have drawn all those who intend to respond into your eternal kingdom. Let your Holy Spirit plead with every heart, every mind, every soul. Enable us to recognize that time is running out. At this camp, we would have heard much about your end-time events, about the early and the latter rain, and about your 1888 message of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And we recognize that you are calling us to be a part of the ministry of that fourth angel who is flying even now in the midst of heaven through a movement of people on earth who have a system of truth and belief with them and who are being sanctified by that truth and who are intend to go forth conquering and to conquer. Hallelujah. Forgive us wherein we have sinned and come short. Help us to truly accept the Laodicea message, to recognize that we are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Amen. And that we cannot save ourselves. Nothing in our hands we bring this evening, dear Father, simply to thy cross we cling. Father, we have come to the end of another camp meeting. A week has passed. You have said much to us. Your Spirit has been pleading with hearts and souls, with families, with spouses, husbands and wives. Father, you want to save all of us in your eternal kingdom, but you cannot force our will. So you are pleading for us to yield to the Spirit of right, to the Spirit of truth and righteousness, to be controlled by the attitude and the mind of Jesus Christ, and to have the faith of Jesus, which justifies, which faith will enable us to become more patient and truly to keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Amen. Father, you know every heart and mind here gathered this evening. You want to do a work in our hearts so that we can all become consecrated vessels, clean and turned right side up for the outpouring of your Holy Spirit in Lateran measure. We want to be sanctified by your Lateran truth so that we can be so pure that we can receive your showers of power to proclaim your last warning message to mankind and thus hasten the coming of Jesus Christ. Like Job, we want to accept your challenge to prove you right and to prove Satan wrong. And so everyone bowing even at this time, search our hearts as with a lighted candle. Show us the defects in our character. Help us not to be worried about others' opinion about us, but to be concerned about what Jesus thinks about us. Help us to recognize that it is him that you are looking at, our prototype. It is from him that you will get copies of Jesus through our lifestyle as we reflect his image by beholding him. Bless every family here represented, every member, every parent, every child. We ask you to consecrate them even now as they yield their spirit, soul, and their bodies to you. Give us consecrated minds, consecrated heart, consecrated lips, consecrated feet, so that we would walk after the manner of Jesus and not after the manner of the world. We thank you for already lifting us to sit with Christ in heavenly places. And now as we behold Jesus, continue to sanctify us. May this camp meeting not just be another camp meeting. May this camp meeting see individuals moving on from strength to strength, growing in Jesus Christ by beholding him and doing a wonderful work for Jesus Christ. For you have said in your word that those that be wise shall shine as the stars of heaven, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Father, make us to have your spirit of missionary work so that we can touch the lives of others, showing them that what your power has done in us, it can do in them as well. And by the revelation of your character through us, may others see and know that Jesus Christ is coming soon. Bless every individual here again. Thank you for all that has said. May this word that has been spoken be not said or spoken in vain, but may it find lodgment in every heart, enable us to recognize that we must give account for all that we have heard, and even what we did not hear, what we could have heard, we shall have to give an account for. And even if we might have missed some presentation, may we go over it and study the books that have been distributed so that we can make this message our own. And when others see what the message has done for us, it will recommend itself to them. They too will want the experience that we have. So we consecrate ourselves to you now. We dedicate our lives to your service. Grant success to all our efforts. Beat back the forces of evil and let truth triumph and no shame or reproach be brought to the name of Jesus. So bless us again. Grant us the heavenly sitting that we long for and that renewed Christian experience. We thank you for being the prayer hearing and prayer answering God that you are. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.